Photo scanning is great for building out your 3D scenes and environments, and you can very easily create large rocks, tree stumps, and human faces without having to model anything. However, scanning an object in its entirety presents some challenges. Somehow we need to work out how to scan the underside of the object. If you're using reality capture, this process is fairly straightforward, and I've left a link in the description to a really great tutorial which will guide you through the entire process. However, if you're looking for a free and open source route, then you want to look elsewhere. The process that I'm about to show you is the same one I used in my photoscanned fruit asset pack, which you can download for free in the description of this video. And by the end of this video, you should be able to create versatile 3D assets of virtually any object you have lying around in your house. Firstly, we need to capture our images. For this, I used a DSLR camera set to RAW, so that I would have much more control over the amount of compression and the post-processing of the images later. However, feel free to use a mobile phone for this. If you're using a DSLR, try to keep your ISO as low as possible in order to reduce noise in your images, and also try to keep your shutter speed quite high in order to decrease motion blur. Trust me, when you're scanning an object, no matter how stable you think you're holding the camera in each shot, there will always be some shots with a bit of motion blur. Fortunately, this isn't usually too much of an issue, but just ensure that the majority of your images are crisp and clear. Also, keep your aperture as small as you can in order to ensure that as much of the object as possible is in focus. You will need to balance all three settings in order to ensure that you are getting the most out of each of them, whilst also ensuring that your image remains bright enough. Next, circle around your object at least 2 to 3 times, taking images as you go. After each circle, change your angle and height in order to give our 3D scanning software as much information about our object as we can. Try to take as many images as possible when doing this. I took around 60 images per scan, which is quite low, and I should have aimed to have more like 100, but I found that this was still sufficient. Once you have completed the first scan, turn over your object and repeat the same process on the other side. Bonus tip! If you want to distinguish clearly between the end of the first scan and the start of the second one, wait about 2 minutes between the two. That way you will be able to tell easily when the second scan begins by the difference in time shown in the file explorer. You should now separate these into two different folders, one containing the first scan and one containing the second. Okay, so now we have the images for the scans off the top of our object and the bottom. The next step is to color correct these images. For this I'll be using RAW Therapy, which in keeping with the theme is a free and open source RAW image editing application. Open up RAW Therapy and navigate in the built-in file browser to the folder containing the images from the first scan. Double-click on the first image and under the drop-down below Processing Profiles, select Neutral. If the image, like mine, was too dark, then increase the lightness of the image. Under Color, I also tweaked the temperature and altered the tint slightly, as I had shot my images in the evening conditions, which wasn't ideal. You'll now notice that your processing profile has changed to custom, so you'll want to save this new profile and call it whatever you want. Back in the file browser, use Ctrl+A to select all of your images, right-click on them, and select Processing Profiles, Apply, My Profiles, and select the profile that you just created. Then click on Put to Queue, and under Queue you can adjust the file format and amount of compression, but the default should be fine. Ensure that Save Processing Parameters with Images deselected, and then select a convenient output location. Then click on the toggle to begin exporting the images. Once these are completed, navigate back to the folder containing the second lot of images, and because we want the images to look the same, we will simply apply the original processing profile and export the second images. We can now finally start to process our scans. For this process, I will be using Meshroom for this, a free and open source program for creating 3D scans based on inputted images. You can find a download link in the description. However, you will need a PC with a GPU, so unfortunately this will not work if you're on a laptop. If this is the case for you, consider using one of the mobile applications, such as Polycam. The advantage of this is that if you have a newer iPhone with a LiDAR sensor, you will be able to use it with Polycam for creating your models. If you're using Meshroom, drag and drop the images of one of the scans into the images section. I've also found that recently, for some reason, the scans will not output correctly unless I change the downscale amount under the depth map node to 4. Feel free to play around with the other nodes, but the default should be fine for our purposes, so we can hit start and wait for our scan to finish processing, which may take around an hour or two depending on your hardware. Once the first scan is complete, do the exact same for the second one, and then we can move on to merging the two scans together. If you wanted to, you could simply remove the ground from both of the scans in Blender, and then attempt to align them. However, this is very difficult to get right, and there is a much easier way, using another free and open source program called CloudCompute. Link is in the description. Click File, Open, and select the first mesh, and then do the same for the second. Then hide one of the meshes and click on the scissors tool to remove the ground from the scan, as well as any glitchy geometry. Try to keep as much of the original scan as possible. We want about a 10-20% overlap between the models in order to ensure there are no gaps. Once you have selected the area which you want to remove, click on this button and then click the confirm and delete hidden points button. Do the same again for the other model and then roughly align the two models so that one is hovering just above the other. Now we can begin to align the two more accurately. Select both models in the database tree and click on the button to align. You can select whichever model you want for the aligned entity and then click OK. Now you need to look around your models to try and find any areas of the texture that are the same on both models. Double click on each one in precisely the same position and try and find at least 20 common points in order for the final alignment to be as accurate as possible. Try not to leave your points all in one area, as this may skew the final alignment. If you're unsure if one part of the texture is actually the part that you're seeing on the other model, do not select this as one of your points, as it could also potentially skew the alignment. Once you're happy with the points that you've selected, click on Align, and then click on the tick to confirm the alignment. As you can see, it's now done a pretty good job at aligning our models, and we can now merge the two models into one mesh before exporting it out as an OBJ. You can now open up Blender and import your model. To remove any loose geometry, in Edit mode, hover over each mesh and press L to select connected parts. Then click Ctrl-I to invert your selection, and press X to delete the vertices. Now we need to retopologize the entire model in order both to connect the meshes up properly, as well as to make for more usable and efficient geometry. I won't go over this process in too much detail, but essentially, you want to add a plane with a subdivision surface modifier, and add a shrink wrap modifier with the target object being the combined scans, and an offset of around 0.001. Although be sure to change this back to 0 once you've finished the retopology process. After this, simply trace over the original objects, keeping your geometry as clean as possible. You can use the subdivision surface modifier to determine the resolution that you want your model to be, which is very useful if you're wanting a model that can be used in a video game or a more high-res one for an architectural visualization concept. Once you're happy with your geometry, you can apply your modifiers and set the offset back to 0 on the shrink wrap modifier. Before we bake the textures onto our new model, we need to UV unwrap our model in order to prevent any texture stretching. Again, I'm not going to go into too much detail on this, but essentially you need to add a new image texture so the generator type to UV grid, and add UV seams to your model in order to get the grid to be as even as possible. Alternatively, if you're looking for a quicker solution, simply pressing U, Smart UV Project will be good enough for most purposes. Now that we've done that, we can move on to baking the textures. Create a new image texture onto the new object, set the generator type back to blank, and then change the dimensions and name it to whatever you want. Just keep the dimensions the same for both the width and height. With the texture selected, select the original model, then the new retopologized model, and in the Render Properties panel, set the render engine to Cycles. A new option titled Bake should appear, and under that, set the Bake type to Diffuse, limit the contributions to Color only, and enable Selected to Active, with an extrusion of 0.2. Next, hit Bake, and the textures from the original model will now be projected onto our newly created texture. Open an image editor and save this image out to somewhere convenient, and we can now start fixing some of the issues with the texture. The main thing we need to solve is the fact that there is still a clear line showing where one of the scans was and where the other was. To do this, switch from object mode to texture painting mode, and using the clone brush, control click on an area of the texture that you want to paint over to cover up a seam, and paint over this section. Ensure that the strength is set to 1 in order to fully cover up each seam, and if like me you're using a drawing tablet, disable strength pressure in order to ensure that the pressure you're applying to your tablet is not contributing to the strength of the brush. Although I also like to change this to some parts in order to add a bit more detail over areas of the seams that I've just covered. Take your time with this process, as ultimately the textures can make or break a model. If some areas of your texture are too dark in comparison to the rest of the texture, can use the draw brush and under the brush settings set the blend mode to add and decrease the strength of the brush significantly. When you're happy with your texture, resave it, and at this stage, the model's complete. That is where I got up to with my Photoscan 3D asset pack, but if you want to push the realism of your model further, we can generate some normal and roughness maps using another free and open source program called Materialize. If, like me, you use Linux, you'll find that there's no download link available for your operating system. However, fortunately, since Materialize is open source and it's built using Unity, there is an unofficial build made for Linux. I've put links in the description to both downloads. So open up Materialize and click the O under the diffuse map to select the baked texture that we've created. Next, even if we're not going to use it, we need to create a height map. Just have a play around with the settings until you're pleased with the result. Then do the same for the normal and roughness maps. You're free to create other maps as well, but in my case, I don't think that the other maps will add overly much to my model. Once you're happy, you can save out your new textures and add them to your material in Blender. I was noticing some lines appearing, which was caused by my normal map, so I used the same technique as earlier to clone areas of the texture in order to hide the seams, which I recommend you do anyway. However, this did not solve my problem. I found that in order to solve this, I had to change the color space from sRGB to non-color, and this solved my problem. So now you should understand the full process of how you can take your photo scanning skills to the next level. If you think there's anything else I should have mentioned, feel free to let me know in the comments down below. Other than that, my Photoscan Fruit Asset Pack is available for free in the description, and I'll see you in the next video.